Today we are joined by Gregory Woodhill and Dan Lacovara, and we are going to talk today about pornography addiction.
Thank you for coming. We wanted to start just by asking around, have any of you had, by show of hands, clients in whatever field you work in that you've worked with who have said they struggle with porn addiction, compulsive porn use, or I can't stop watching porn, by show of hands? Okay. That's most of a good majority of the people in the room. Have any of you ever initiated that conversation? Meaning talking to a client, we're assessing, you know, we're taught to assess for drugs and alcohol and safety issues. Have any of you, I don't necessarily mean in the first session, but actually asked a client without any prompting, what's your relationship to porn, by show of hands? A couple, okay, good, four or five, yeah. So for any of you that just said that you've had experience, we just want to literally take a minute or two here. What's been your experience? What have you done? Has it, for yourself, like as far as your own countertransference, has it been difficult? Has it made you uncomfortable? Have you found great success? Have you been flummoxed? Any thoughts? Sir, in the back.
Hey. So I do something, usually work with writers and artists, so guys come to me sometimes and say they use a lot of porn or video games, and then I help them do something more meaningful.
Mm. So they're spending a lot of their time doing porn, gaming,
and
then you help them move to things that are more right brain and more creative, more fulfilling.
Yeah, and something they say they really love, but they don't ever get around doing.
Okay,
so
sure.
How to make that switch.
Right, and porn and gaming can be a beautiful tool of procrastination, for sure. Yes, sir.
It seems like it's kind of an insidious addiction, meaning a lot of the people I've worked with who struggle with it have been watching porn since they were 11.
Okay.
And that's just been their way.
Yeah. That's huge, and more as time goes on, yes? We'll talk a little bit about that later, how things have changed, how someone, in most cases, couldn't have watched porn from age 11 many years ago. Now it's it would almost be hard to avoid it. It's a fascinating topic, so much so that we choose to do it for a living. And it's really my passion, my hot button in I do treat sex addiction here, but pornography addiction, or pornography compulsivity, or just even problems with porn is one of the things that I'm most drawn to in working with clients. So we want to start just by talking about what is pornography, because it's an interesting question, and a bit of an infamous quote here by Supreme Court Associate Judge Potter Stewart. What is pornography? He said, I know it when I see it. So that's a bit problematic, isn't it? Because all of us would have a different definition for what that means. Now, to be fair to this gentleman, he has passed. He later said he wished that it was a big paragraph where this was one of the lines, and that short part became infamous. He said he wished he wouldn't have said it, he wished he would have said it in a different context, and to be fair, when he said it, he was actually ruling that something that was at the Supreme Court was not pornography. He was saying, I know pornography when I see it, and this is not it. So, you know, I was looking for this presentation, and we were looking for different definitions of literally what is pornography, and so many of them look exactly like this here. The representation of the human body or sexual activity with the goal of sexual arousal. So, does anyone else find that a little vague? Does that mean that a billboard with someone very sexy, male or female, on it is pornography? Some might say yes, right?
And in Victorian England, they would cover up chair legs, which are considered too erotic.
Chair legs in the past.
In the 19th century.
Right, we consider pornographic. My dad's in his early 80s, and he was saying, I can't remember exactly, but there was some movie many, 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 many decades ago where a woman showed her legs or her arms or something, and it was like scandalous. This was in theaters. So it changes, obviously, because we change as a culture. So for our purpose here today, what we're referring to when we say porn or pornography is our visual images or videos, usually people who are naked, and many times in sexual acts that people use, frankly, to be aroused and to masturbate to. And why is pornography a problem? Well, our answer is it's not. It's not a problem inherently. I want to be really clear, we don't pathologize pornography or pornography use. It's not a sickness, and we were just talking a moment ago before, we have no moral, ethical, religious standpoint against porn. I'm not anti-porn. what happens here, and I say, and those who are, I support them too. Mm-hmm. However, what we see here, we don't ever tell, I've never told anyone, you have a porn problem if they didn't think they did. What I mean to say is people come here and say, I can't stop. There's a difference between someone watching porn, whether it's adventurous, whether it's 14 times a week or once a week or once a year, that if it's working for them and their life isn't hindered and they're not in distress about it, then I have no need to change it. We have no need to change it. So I want to make sure that's clear here. We're not here to demonize porn. That's not what we're talking about here today. But we don't disagree with anybody who does. I support anybody's opinion. But it's not a problem unless it is. Unless it is. I see that the light's on. I guess we'll let them. Ah, yay for porn. So we've been told, and this is, you may be confused if we didn't tell you this. For our purposes today, they're recording us, this presentation, so we've been told whoever's speaking needs to stand near the microphone, so we're going to be switching
dance
many
moves.
Times. Dance moves. So please forgive us for that. So,
my turn.
Dan, let's try to switch.
Okay, so yes, yay for porn. As Greg said, there's nothing wrong with porn if it doesn't feel wrong to you and you're able to sort of balance that out with the rest of your life. Again, pathologizing any kind of sexual acts is very dangerous, and pornography is one of those areas we're very careful not to pathologize. So porn's upside. Porn does have an upside in lots of different ways. It can be educational. I mean, this sound, you know, how do teenagers learn about sexuality in many ways? Through viewing pornography. I mean, there's one thing to have parents talk to you about the birds and the bees, and there's another thing to see what those birds and bees do. So on some level, if it is within, I mean, I don't know, how many of you have children or teenage children? Okay, just wait, no. I mean, part of their process of discovery and discovering their own sexuality in private, most teenagers are gonna look at pornography. So if you think they're not, think again, and if you're putting blocks on their computers again, that's up to you. It's fun, as Greg said. I mean, it's exciting to watch, you know, it's arousing. It allows you to live out certain fantasies that you might not want to live out in reality, whether it's because they're hard to find or uncomfortable or you're afraid of judgment around it. So I think it's really important, as Greg said, to look at pornography as a way to live an exciting fantasy life sexually. There are no other ways you can do that as easily. And unfortunately, the proliferation of porn sometimes makes it too easy to get connected to it, addicted to it, and then to step out of reality altogether, which is what we'll talk about. And go ahead. Did you want? So this concept of feeling shame around family of origins, FOO, family of origin, sexual messages. You know, there's the birds and the bees, there's sex is shameful, sex should only be between a man and a woman, sex should only be after marriage, I was going to say before marriage. Sex should only be before marriage.
Or even that sex should only be making love.
Right. Can't be fun, visceral, can't be, you know, this concept of whether it's S&M or B&D. All those messages somehow get put into us, and pornography allows us to maybe start to deconstruct those messages and to figure out what we might like sexually, right? Rather than, this is what mom and dad said, or someone else said, or society said is right.
Tag out?
I'm out.
Okay. This feels awkward. Okay, so the evolution of modern pornography, I think some of us in the room are old enough to have tracked it somehow. Starting, obviously, we're not going to go all the way back to hieroglyphics here, but there were books with nudity, books that depict sexual acts. Magazines, obviously, the porno magazines for many decades were how a lot of people discovered pornography. There's that old cliche of dad's porno mags. I saw these, which is always interesting to me that at a really young age, this is such a side note here, but at 7, 8, 9, 10 years old, it's interesting to find dad's porno magazines because we don't, even at our age, want to think about our parents as sexual beings in general, right? So to find a magazine showing this is what, let's say, dad or mom looks at and is aroused by, that's an interesting thing for a kid to hold all by themselves. I'm not quite sure what a kid does with that, but it sinks in somehow. Mm-hmm. And I think it's confusing on different levels to different people. So, Dad, were you going to say something?
You know, I was saying, you know, in developmentally, as Greg was referring to, kids can't make sense of it. You know, seeing pornography at the age of 7, 8, 9, and we have a lot of clients, whether it's depending on their age, who said, yeah, I found dad's stash, or the neighbor kids had, you know, Hustler, Playboy, and now, as we know, magazines, if people still look at them, are even more graphic. So their brains are still in this developmental stage where left brain, I can't really necessarily make sense of what I'm seeing. So the arousal happens, the excitement, and you're not sure what's going on. So it's
right.
really traumatizing from, I would say, for the majority of children who are under a certain age to go, what am I seeing? Because there's no context for it.
Sure, what am I seeing? What am I feeling?
Yeah.
What do I make of any of this? And we're going to talk a little bit about this at the very end, especially with working with teenagers, that to be able to have this conversation, and I know people who are parents of 5, 6, 7-year-olds who are already worried about, when do I talk to them about pornography? Mm-hmm. When do I talk to them about, because they're going to have feelings, and for them not to be acknowledged and not to be talked about can be really harmful, because we don't know what to do with those feelings. Our brain literally isn't ready to deal with that yet. So obviously movie theaters, right, these, especially in the 70s and the 80s, like these movie houses that would project, and people would go to the theaters and sit and masturbate and sometimes, you know, have sexual activity with each other. Go ahead.
No, I was going to talk about the booths. Go ahead.
Okay, yeah.
And then thinking about them.
Adult bookstores, booths. This is when video really started to become, I don't know.
Prevalent
is the word I was looking for. That adult bookstores, which were porn stores, which also had sex toys and movies, you could go and the shelves were lined with videos, but then they had booths in the back with doors sometimes that would lock sometimes, that had, you know, holes to look through and touch through sometimes and sometimes not. That people would feed coins or dollars into that, and then they could change the channel and see a bunch of different things of pornography, which is interesting. Was a bit of like a precursor to the way internet pornography is today, meaning that they could, for the first time, they could just hit click, click, click. They couldn't move it forward or backwards. They couldn't, but it would just be on loop. There would be, let's say, 60 VCRs running, and the person in any of the different booths. So people would go and they would masturbate to that in private. You want to say about that?
No, I was also thinking. I mean, there could be argument for anyone knew Times Square in the 70s and early 80s, the peep shows. Sort of this concept of live pornography, you know, not
sure.
necessarily touching, not interacting, but having this experience of women doing either what you want them to do, because you could ask them, or in sexual situations. And so, again, this, you know, in secret, easy access, don't have to interact with another person, because that's not real interaction. So sort of this concept of live pornography.
Right. And this, you know, VHS, obviously we all know that I've heard many times that VHS won over Beta because VHS struck a humongous deal with pornography. Mm-hmm. And that was that. Goodbye, Beta. My family owned Beta, so it's not to be us.
Still got those tapes, not the porn tapes.
Yeah.
Star Wars Episode 1.
With nothing to play on.
That's exactly.
Cable television obviously came along, became the Playboy Channel, the Spice Network, many, many others that people could watch it. Whether, you know, I know many people who, as teens, watched Scrambled. Right, that was exciting enough. It was like just enough of a hit. Oh, yeah, see something? I can hear what they're doing.
Or even the Red Shoe Diaries, which was softcore. There was a lot of soft. There still is a lot of softcore porn out there, which gives whoever's watching it just enough to get them either going or to stimulate them.
Yes.
But so it's, you think about how prevalent, and there's argument about whether, you know, lots of cable shows have pornographic scenes.
Right.
And for a porn addict, that can be very triggering.
Sure.
They don't have to be looking at porn to start that process of going to pornography.
If you haven't seen this, I wish, I didn't even think about it till now, so if you're interested, write this down. Go to YouTube and type in, it's not porn, it's HBO. If you've seen this, it's brilliant. It's brilliant. I won't talk much about it because it's just, it's fantastic. It's one of these, leads you in one direction at the very end, it takes you another one. It's exactly what we're talking about. It's not porn, it's HBO. It's beautiful. It's a it's a kind of a joke video. It's about a minute long. And then DVD, obviously. What DVD did, we could fast forward and rewind VHS tapes, but DVDs never run out. They never break. They never get, well, they can break, if you know what I mean. Not like a VHS tape. So it's like people could skip to different things. They could have different special features. And then, of course, the graduation to the internet. The internet, you know, we don't need to talk about how much it changed the world. It changed pornography drastically, and we're gonna talk a little bit about this as we go on, but this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Everybody has, almost everybody has a computer in their pocket all the time. A lot of kids have iPhones, a lot of teenagers have iPhones, a lot of teenagers have unrestricted iPhones, they can look up and see whatever they want. That I was just thinking last night, I was talking to somebody about this. In 15 seconds, I could have illegal pornography on this phone, right now.
No one would know.
No, well, except the FBI, if they have a way.
That's
pretty, what's that?
Who's in the neighborhood who wants to have sex with you?
Well, sure, yeah, so that's, yeah, that's a different lecture entirely, exactly, like how to find
I don't know why it takes 15.
Right.
I can do it in 7.5.
Geico, right. So I've been bested by 7.5 seconds, and that's important. It's exactly, and if you have things bookmarked, 2 seconds.
Right. You know, it's so, I was thinking about this, even the other kinds of inventions, think about the remote control with a DVD. No string, plugging it in, you can freeze frame, you can rewind very quickly. So even sort of the most innocuous evolution in technology can become support a porn addiction.
Absolutely.
Remote control.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So back in the day, the way, and we're going to have to go pretty quickly through these, finite. If you bought a tape, you come to the end of it at some point. You can rewind it and watch it again. You can loop that one tape, but it's finite. A magazine, you read it, you look at the pictures, comes to an end. You can only see that material so many times. Not true with the infinite, with the internet. Did I write this? The internet is literally infinite. It's infinite. Since we've started this lecture, I'll bet you 1,000 new clips of pornography that were just made were put online. I mean, that's how quickly it goes. And the other stuff doesn't go away. So it's infinite, it's always being created. People can get caught. Now, anyone who wants to erase their browser history knows how to do that, but even that's trackable. Why is your browser history erased if someone goes to look at it? However, you can get caught with a DVD, you can get caught with a magazine, right? There's proof. The internet, you turn it off, it's gone. Other than, yes, sir?
You can also be seen coming out of a store. By
Absolutely. You can get caught, which is, they had to interface with other people in order to get it. I know a lot of friends, personally and a lot of people professionally, who talked about going and renting pornography or buying pornography, and they were aware of which person they were gonna, let's say they went to like the warehouse, or a place that was that sold pornography and also 98% normal films. You're going up with 3 or 4 pornographic tapes, and you have to deal with somebody. So you make that decision, I'm willing to cross, to jump through this hoop, of getting the cute girl or the cute guy that I don't want to know I'm renting a stack of pornography to go masturbate to. It was like a boundary or a barrier that you had to get over, so you had to go through that loop. Not true today.
Checking out in a hotel.
Checking out in a hotel. What do you mean?
If that night the guest wanted to watch porn.
Watch porn, right.
There it is. Right. Who watched that and what time? And
it shows up discreetly on your bill, but the people checking you out, they know what
you're
doing.
They know what you're doing.
There's a trail. You had to interface with other people. You could get caught, even if it was by people you didn't know. So there was an embarrassment factor. Is that true with pornography? I mean, we have 4 walls, we have locked doors. We get to control who sees us, who doesn't. It's a very isolated experience. There was a limit to how disturbing the available material was. I don't mean to say that you couldn't find it, but let's say I wanted to watch something that, or even know that something existed that was violent or visceral or disturbing to a person, even if it was arousing to them, they might not even know how to find it. How do I get that? They might go their whole life with never. And to go, we'll talk a little bit about this more later, so I'm not going to say too much, but it has the potential to feed that wolf inside the person's head, especially if there's childhood abuse or trauma in their background that they're that they have eroticized. To watch that in pornography is playing out that trauma for them. I say that can be the truth, where to never have access to that type of pornography that is 7.5 seconds away on our phones right now, it can be really harmful to someone to be able to have that access. And then all of those forms of pornography, for adults at least, were legal, at least the types we're talking about. The most common, obviously, form of illegal pornography is underage. So I think everybody knows this, but anyone below the age of 18 who is shown in pornography either naked or in any sort of sexual act is illegal. Now, we're not going to get into sexting, like teenagers sending. That is considered child pornography these days by law. We could spend a whole hour and a half talking just about that, so we're not going to cover that today. But if someone wanted illegal pornography, I don't know how they would get it. And if they did, they would have to jump through some major, major, major legal hoops to get it. These days, like we said, 7.5 seconds away. Whose turn? Yours.
is my turn?
Yeah, let's switch places. How about
that? All right. So we're switching. So, you know, we did, as Greg said, you know, online pornography is exploding. And we were looking for estimates on how much, what the industry revenue each year. The low end was $4 billion. I mean, how do people track reporting? And you've got to remember, it's not just pay for services, it's all the advertisers. And if you look at, if you look at sites that you go to that are not technically pornography sites, there are advertisers all over the place that are one or two steps away, and if you click one, you may not know where you're going, but the next advertiser will take you to a porn site. Mm-hmm. So that advertising is embedded across the internet, or as I call it, the interweb. And so you don't know where you're going. And so, and there's a tremendous, I mean, the algorithms that have been created to get people to porn sites, it's phenomenal. I mean, people spend their days figuring out how to get you from a healthy site, quote unquote healthy, a regular site to porn. Yeah. So this concept of being the great accelerator of sexual compulsivity and problematic behavior, this can be a real great starting point for somebody. Somebody who has a predilection for acting out behavior, sexual compulsivity, can start the process very easily. It's completely impersonal. You don't have to do a lot besides click on your computer, click on a certain site, put something in your search engine, and they're your. So they're, you're there. So people who might not in the past have been able to move into that compulsive behavior because literally it was too difficult to do, there's no problem whatsoever. You can go there in a heartbeat, and as they say, it's off to the races, right? For anyone who's got any kind of predilection to addiction in general. So
the question is why? Like you were saying, well, we already said a bit of this, so we'll go quickly through this. Perceived anonymity, right? No one knows us, this includes chatting, whatever, but no one knows what we're watching, so we feel. Our internet service provider knows exactly where we've been. If the FBI or Homeland Security wants to know what websites you've been on, it would take them less than 7.5 seconds, right? They could find that information immediately. So it's not as anonymous as we think, but it feels that way. It's impersonal. Look, I'm not hurting anybody. The porn's on there. I'm just watching it. And easy access and little skill to use. I'm thinking about, there's a 5-year-old kid who knows how to, because I told him my code, unlock my phone, go through my files, go to the music section and play the songs he likes. He knows that. This is a 5-year-old child, and I'm sure there's 4-, 3-, and 2-year-olds who do it. Please, they beg for iPad time now in preschool, right? I never begged for iPad time when I was in preschool, right? I wouldn't have gotten it, so I knew
nap
that.
Time.
Nap time, exactly. So iPads, phones, I say, kids know how to do it. It's easy. Like you, like Dan was just saying a second ago, Google, right? Google will bring us to anything we want or bring us somewhere where we can get it. As far as, and we're going to talk in a moment about what sex addiction even means or what porn addiction even means. So if you have that question, if you're wondering what we're even talking about, just hold on. We're going to get to literally how to assess for that. It's called the crack cocaine of sexual compulsivity. And when we say sexual compulsivity, we're talking about any behaviors that are addictive or compulsive, whether that's affairs, prostitutes, going to massage parlors for happy endings, pornography, exposing yourself, frauderism, I think I said affairs already, anything that's compulsive or addictive that you can't stop, that's what we're talking about as a crack cocaine. Not that someone who watches porn is going to be an addict in 2 minutes. That's not what we're saying. Not that that couldn't happen. But no real-life partner can compete with the dopamine blasts that are created in the brain by internet pornography, specifically internet pornography. And I'll say why. It can create addiction where there is no addictive template. Patrick Carnes is the godfather of sex addiction treatment, as I like to call him. He came up with this phrase, and he talked about when they started doing inpatient treatment for people with sex addiction, they were studying and coming up with a template of like, okay, if we line up 1,000 people who identify as a sex addict, and we say, how many of you came from rigid, disengaged households? Maybe 80, 90% would raise their hands. How many of you came from where there was no affection and it was X, Y, and Z, or overly affectionate where you felt smothered? And a good 80, 90%, I'm making up those numbers, would raise their hand. Suddenly people started showing up and they didn't fit into any category. And they started seeing, why are we not seeing this template anymore? This is why. It's because internet pornography was taking people who would not have had an addictive template to begin with, that weren't going online to find a way to escape, to numb, to distract from everyday life.
They just watch porn because they were interested. And because of the way internet porn, and we're gonna talk a little bit about why later, affects the brain, they got hooked on the porn. I've heard, I can't say from experience, that the same is true for crack cocaine. That if you do crack cocaine once, you can be addicted immediately. I have to go with the experts on that one. And we are overstimulated by the marketing availability, and our adrenaline dopamine rushes are greater than a real-life sexual encounter could actually create. We're going to talk about why in a moment as well. So I've said this to many guys. If you are watching, and I work mainly with men, so if I say guys, forgive me for, but you know, women present and they report very similar things as well. That if you watched pornography and masturbated to this scene with this porn star, let's say, and you measure the dopamine rushes in your brain, which is the feel-good chemical we're gonna talk about in a moment, and then you went and recreated that scene in that room with that porn star, there'd be more dopamine released in your brain by you watching and masturbating it than if you were actually doing it. And this isn't the most scientific answer you're gonna hear all day, but the reason is because your brain knows the difference between fantasy and reality, and fantasy, it's easier to live in the dopamine chemicals. It's easier for those feel-good blasts. Your brain knows you're in the room with a real human being who has needs, right? Whether you wanna take care of those needs is up to you, but your brain knows the difference. So that fantasy is like a beautiful wall or like a glass wall where you're safe behind there for your brain to just really indulge in it, as opposed to, oh, I'm actually with someone here and I need to take them into consideration. Not true with pornography. This is still me, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the user can seek out to resolve the unresolved issues around sexuality and courtship from a past. This is what I was talking about earlier. A lot of people, when we get into their template of what they like with pornography, they are re-traumatizing themselves. They're playing out unhealed issues from the past. Is this true for everyone with porn? Of course not. Of course not. But it is true for many who watch a certain kind of porn, whether it's violent or degrading or visceral or child or this or that, and many people are trying to work out issues from the past, but what this does, like I said earlier, it feeds the wolf. Mm-hmm. It feeds that hungry wolf inside that doesn't know what it's doing necessarily, and it's just re-traumatizing itself over and over again. And then it's eroticizing the pain more and more as they're trying to work it out without realizing they're trying to. It can extend to non-internet behaviors. Fantasies can turn into behaviors. Many times it doesn't. With addicts, many times it does. I did this for years, and then suddenly it just wasn't that fun anymore. It just didn't get me off anymore. So then I started looking at real ads from real escorts. Then I called. I wasn't going to go out, but I'm just going to call and hear the voice and hang up. And then what happens? Well, then I was just going to meet and see, and then it can extend. And then, like Dan was saying earlier, when sex addicts are in recovery with a grouping of behaviors, many times, if it involves porn, that porn is the main reason for relapse. People come in all the time, I was this or that, I watch porn. I was testing my internet blocker, which we're gonna talk about later as well, mm-hmm. And guess what, I got through. Rabbit holes. YouTube is a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant website. What YouTube introduced to us, because I hadn't seen it before YouTube, is if you like this, what do? They show you 10, 15 other ones that you will like. I'll admit, my brother will send me from time to time, like dog and kitten playing, and I love that, and I watch it, and then there's, if you like this dog and kitten, you might love this, and here's a deer playing with a rabbit, and here's this and that, and I 3 hours later, I've called clients to cancel, I don't come into work because I'm watching dogs and rabbits. But we do this, right? We go on there for a minute, we stay for an hour.
And I also think that you can find images in YouTube or experiences in YouTube that one might not consider pornographic if you're a sex addict, a porn addict. And then that's the addict brain saying, well, this doesn't count. So if you're saying, I'm not going to any porn sites or I've got my filters on, that's not necessarily going to work.
Right.
So addicts, as we all know who work with them, our addict brain is sneaky. Right? All it wants to do is get its fix. So it's going to figure out how to do that without, you know, breaking sobriety. So I think that's also important to know that if you're working with clients who have porn addiction, you really have to talk about sort of the entire internet experience, because it's just way too easy for them either to find it or to be triggered.
Yeah.
Images of people in bathing suits trigger our clients to act out. Mm-hmm. So really thinking about the overall experience of someone who's addicted to the internet, because that's what pornography online is, we need to think about where they're going to be able to find something that might be a trigger for them to act out.
Yeah. And what's dangerous about this is that people who sell pornography are anything but stupid. YouTube gets us to stay on there for an hour, in my case, looking at, you know, cats and dogs playing. But in pornography, what has happened and the evolution of it, it used to be, if you like this, you'll probably like these clips too, right? Fine. They take you to their competitors. They take you to their own other clips from their own website. Now there's advertising, and the advertising moves, right? They used to be still images. Now those images move. So it's like this with your brain. It's like fireworks and neon and dopamine. It's a party when you're watching this. And what it will do is they will show something that's a little bit disturbing. A little bit like, oh gosh, that's a little more violent than I'm interested in, but a little more. So I'm going to click on that. So that's the new thing. What do you then think is down here? Something a little more off the beaten path, let's say. And people, as what's what we call rabbit holes, they go down the rabbit hole, and 7, 8, 9 generations later, they're watching something that had that popped up immediately, they would have thrown up, so to speak. They wouldn't have watched it. They would never have clicked on it. But when they graduate to that little by little, these people are not stupid. Somebody watching 90s pornography with, you know, two people having sex is not necessarily going to say, oh, here's animals, or here's someone getting beaten, or here's this or that. It's little by little. Now, I want to keep qualifying this. I don't mean to say that this happens for everybody. It doesn't. But especially like we're talking about, for people who have a template where the darker or the more visceral or the more violent or the more abusive appeals to them, this is the staircase down into it. Important in gaming, hijack the brain, creating addiction where there's no trauma present. We've said that already. So this is you.
So for all of us who work with addicts or have had experiences dealing with them, you know, obviously we talk about the addictive system and the addictive cycle. We don't have that up here, but you can find it pretty much anywhere. And again, there's a little bit of a shift when you're looking at addiction, sex addiction. But what I think a lot of people don't realize, if you're not really studying or into the neurobiological aspects of it, is there's tons of stuff happening at the brain at the same time that gets you to the place of wanting porn, enjoying porn, and needing more of it. So what happens here? So you have norepinephrine goes up, right? And what does that do? It triggers your fight, flight, actually, or freeze response. So physiologically, you start to get excited, right? Blood flow, heart rate, enthusiasm for whatever you're doing. And then as Greg pointed out, you've got this dopamine burst, right? This feels good, I want more of it. Focused, it's very important to talk about focused attention, because there are people who, as we will talk, spend hours and hours and hours looking at porn. Sometimes they edge, which means they'll just masturbate, but not have an orgasm. Mm-hmm. Because the experience, the physical sensation, and how they are sucked into that pornography, they don't want to give it up. They want to see how long they can keep this going. And then you have the drop in serotonin, which is what also keeps the libido going up, right? So you've got these things going, you've got up, up, and down. And that we see a lot of sex addicts and certainly porn addicts who have mood disorders. There is correlation with OCD, because sex addiction, it's a compulsive behavior. We see people with anxiety, generalized anxiety disorders. You see people with agoraphobia, right? So I'm living in this little world. Or depression, and we know depression and anxiety are two sides of the same coin. So if you're working with a sex addict or a porn addict, and we all do this, assess for mood disorders. I bet you sort of probably 7 times out of 10, you're gonna find something, whether it's a severe mood disorder or one of the lesser ones. And we're not talking about thought disorders here. That's a complete separate area.
So if we're talking about dopamine very quickly, as we've talked about, I'm just gonna touch on these couple things. Dopamine is a neurochemical, it feels good. It's the reward and pleasure chemical in the brain. It serves evolutionary purposes, and one of the things it thrives on is variety. Imagine that. It thrives on variety. So if I'm a caveman, however many years ago, and I know this area very well, dopamine is what's going to tell me something's new, something's different. Food, danger. These are the things that my body is looking out for. Dopamine is one of the things. Dopamine feels good. I've heard chocolate is a big a dopamine stimulator, and I actually can attest to that very well, nightly. So the forebrain interprets cocaine use, pornography, gaming in a similar fashion. John, you mentioned gaming and pornography. Those two are fused a ton, especially in teenagers, especially in teenage boys.
All three hyper-stimulate the dopamine cycle. So we're not talking about dopamine as the enemy. What we're talking about is the internet hyper-stimulates dopamine to the brain. It's a flood of dopamine to the brain, says, this feels so good, now I need more of it.
I mean, you can think of Facebook that way. Reading posts, you know, how most people don't spend 2 minutes on Facebook.
Right,
it's fun, it's exciting to read what's going on with someone, to post your information.
Yeah.
So we have to look at dopamine rushes coming all over the place.
Someone
just
said,
picks it up a notch.
I read in an article that emails are a dopamine rush. I didn't think about that, but that's true. Doo-doo, I know the little symbol, but the little chime on my computer. What is it? Oh, it's spam.
Right.
Oh, it's from Dan.
Or a text.
Yeah,
thank
yeah text,
you.
Exactly. Those are dopamine rushes, and I can feel that. We can feel that in our body. Like, oh, who is it? Who?
Right.
The brain becomes dependent on dopamine, not necessarily the porn or the gaming. We're going to talk about that still later. This creates a need to seek greater levels of the neurochemical stimulation. So the dopamine receptors become blunted. So we're talking about being flooded, not these hits now and then, but the flooding. Like Dan was saying, it is not abnormal for someone to come in and say, well, what's normal? How long do you watch pornography? Anywhere between 4 and 8 hours at a time. 4 and 8 hours at a time. Do people come in and say, I called into work today because I was up all night masturbating and I needed to sleep through work? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to say it happens every day, but it happens a lot, right? So they need greater levels of stimulation. The neuroreceptors to the dopamine literally blunt themselves. I say, I can't handle all of this. And what happens is we need more. And we're going to talk about how they get more. Dopamine and oxytocin are released upon orgasm, so the brain actually attaches and bonds to porn as it would a live sexual partner. That's a bit of what my book is going to be about, that Kana mentioned earlier. That it's like this attaching to an experience as opposed to another human being. This is good if we're on a first date. This is good the first time we have sex with someone, the first time we kiss. We call our friends, we're on this euphoric high. When this happens over and over again with an experience with pornography, this happens. Right? Look at this guy. So we, you know, and neurochemically we do, we attach to that experience. It becomes, for some, if it becomes compulsive, if it becomes addictive, it becomes what their sexuality craves more than with a real person. Sir?
Yep. So this was advertised as straight and gay porn. We're learning about straight and gay porn addiction. One of the reasons you haven't, sort of, we're getting to the slides now, is there's really not a lot of information on it. There, you know, I have scoured the internet for studies on gay men and porn addiction. Doesn't exist. So that speaks also to an imbalance in the way, because it's a different experience for gay men. You're gonna have different issues that are gonna come up in treatment. And so the fact that there's none, if anyone wants to work on a study with me, let me know. We need to understand more about how this affects the gay male strata. So, I say porn can be the sexual closet, particularly for men who have sex with men who don't identify as gay or may be closeted. You can live out every sexual experience that you want with a man without anybody knowing about it, without any risk of being discovered, without any bringing on a deeper sense of shame. Because again, the two-person sexual experience is loaded. It's loaded emotionally, physically, psychologically. So if I don't have to go there and try that out, if I can try it out online, I'm safe, I can experience it, and I can also tell myself I'm not necessarily gay because I've never had sex with a man. So it also may foster internalized homophobia. So what is internalized homophobia? Hopefully most of you know that, but gay men and women and bisexuals take in the message that is pretty much has been prevalent and still is prevalent in many ways, that being gay is wrong. Right? It is a pathology, it is a failure of a moral compass, it's bad. And so as many strides as we've made societally, it's existing in most gay men, women, bisexual, transgender. It's just in there. I think it's often in the cell memory. If you've grown up gay anywhere, you're gonna see those negative experiences or negative images. Just by the fact that you do not see lots of posters growing up or billboards of two men kissing or two women kissing. Not a lot of gay parents 30 years ago. So you have this sense of there's something wrong. The outright shame that people bring to their sexuality. Again, it can be reinforced by the pornography viewing, the kind of pornography viewing that's been done. If you look at what happened in the 70s, which was sort of the sexual liberation in the gay community, it was sort of, you know, anything goes. I don't know if anyone saw The Normal Heart, but it just spoke to, before the AIDS epidemic, it's on, and you can do whatever you want. Then when AIDS came along, shame just came right back. We're gay, we're gonna be punished, all straight people hate us, the disease is a curse, that kind of information. So it reinforces it. Denial, I said, about your sexuality. I am not gay because I do not have sex with men, I just watch men having sex with men. Self-injury, we talked a little bit about this, and we'll talk about crystal meth, which is masturbating to the point of injury, but also things like suicidality. I am being gay, internalized homophobia, I don't know how to live in this world. So we have to look at self-injury in many different ways, not just physically, but psychologically, mentally, emotionally. And then sexual acting out. It is the great accelerator. So when you're involved in watching pornography and you have a certain level of internalized homophobia, you may get to that next place. You may want to act out the shame scenario. You know, we were talking about the shadow sides of ourselves or the darker sides of ourselves. Acting out sexually for anybody is a self-punishing endeavor. It is not a sexual endeavor. It is an act of shaming oneself, of harming oneself, and however you look at it, harming another person. We talk about this as intimacy avoidance. One of the reasons I started the Gay Men's Intimacy Group is, again, with all of the issues that I've talked about, and in general, how men are viewed in our society, it's hard to form healthy relationships. Mm-hmm. It's not impossible. Many of us who are gay have healthy relationships, whether they're sexual or friendships. But again, I don't think it has been well modeled in many ways. So what happens is, this allows you to have relationship. Even if it's just a sexual relationship, you have some level of connection. But is there any intimacy in that picture that Greg showed before of someone kissing the computer? No. So we really want people to have the ability to just start to begin, and that's what recovery is about, building intimate relationships. So, huge issue. It has become sort of the issue of the gay community, meth abuse and how it is connected to different sexually acting out behaviors. So what does meth do? It extends the duration of the high. So already you're getting that dopamine blast. And what happens is meth hits really fast and it levels off very quickly. So many people can do more and more of it to keep that dopamine hit going. It fuels the libido. The irony of it fueling the libido is that you can have sex for hours and hours and hours or look at porn for hours and hours, but never have an orgasm. Mm. The use of that drug does not allow, most people really struggle to have an orgasm. So if I'm a porn addict, I can spend hours and days sometimes in that excitement feeling stage without having an orgasm and have to sort of refuel oneself. Like any drug, cocaine, crack, even marijuana, alcohol, it decreases the inhibitions and increases dissociation. So decreasing the inhibitions is, maybe I can do this. Maybe it's okay. And the dissociation really is, I'm disconnected from what I'm doing. This is not a sexual behavior. It's not about sex. It's about disconnection from my reality. So think of any kind of chemical we use, it allows us on some level to disconnect from our reality. One drink, I feel mellow. Mm-hmm. Well, now you're in a dissociative state. And then it reduces the ability for rational thought. Otherwise, you wouldn't be masturbating for 22 hours. You wouldn't be going without water, food. You know, people coming down off meth, if anyone's worked with meth addicts, often have picked their faces to the point of scabbing and bleeding because it's both OCD, you can hallucinate, and most meth has some level of acid in it, right? Because that's how it's made. And again, it's the gateway to sexual acting out. Big deal is the pornography can take you to the online cruising, not just online cruising now. You've got those apps, Grindr, Scruff. People are now using Tinder, both gay men and heterosexuals. Anonymous partners and exposure to HIV. Barebacking has become the way to go for many people, particularly with the dawn of Truvada. Do you all know what Truvada is?
Can you say what barebacking
is? Barebacking is, sorry, sex without condoms. So, and many people use Truvada now, which is it's called PrEP, which is a prophylactic. And if you take it, it shows that 98%, there's a reduction of 98% in the risk of HIV transmission. So if you're on crystal meth, you're taking Truvada, you know, you can hook up with someone easily, you are completely out of your mind. I can do this, there's not gonna be consequence. As Greg said at the beginning, this is all about consequences, right? So how destructive is this behavior? And this is physically, psychologically, and chemically destructive. We doing okay?
Yeah, we're good.
Go on.
We'll carry right along.
So this you have in your PowerPoint, fightthenewdrug.org. It's already on there. I'm not going to talk too much about it. This is what we've already said. Chemicals, neurochemicals are like I said, there's a flooding of them in the brain. The brain rewires itself to expect the chemicals the same way we do with drugs and alcohol. Like we said earlier, tolerance, which we're going to get to in a moment. I keep saying that. We're going to get to that in a moment.
Moments. Life is full of moments.
Right. Setting up anticipation. I hope
so
it works.
Excited.
The brain rewires itself and says, I need this now, right? This is what I live on. This is the standard, just like an alcoholic or a drug addict. Like, this is what my body needs, and I'm going to start to crave it and need it if I don't get it. And then it becomes dependent. It goes from I want and I like these chemicals to I need these chemicals just to go on. And like you were saying a moment ago, Dan, the frontal lobe, the prefrontal lobe, rationalizations, decision-making, rational thought, all get processed through here. Guess which part in all addiction is really circumvented? It's the prefrontal lobe, prefrontal cortex. It's like this is where we make our decisions, and it all becomes this about the neurochemicals, not so much about rational thoughts. How many times do you hear an addict, sex addict or chemical addict or any process addiction, say, what was I thinking? What was I thinking when I did that? And we're talking about porn today. It's like, I masturbated to porn 3-4 hours, and after I was done, I realized, like, my drapes were open. I thought, yeah, they're probably asleep. Like, they could have looked in at any time. Like, I was actually exposed. Or I did some stuff that was actually, like, traceable or illegal. Like, what was I thinking?
And I think it's, again, very important to think of addiction as a dissociative disorder.
Yeah.
If you're not looking at it that way, you're kind of missing a piece of the picture.
Right. So what was I thinking? I didn't want to think.
Right.
I didn't want to feel. It's like, that's their drug. That's how they get out of reality. Very quickly, potential side effects for men, porn addiction, erectile dysfunction and delayed ejaculation. We hear about that all the time. We have sex therapists here at CHS. We consult regularly with sex therapists. Anytime someone comes in, if it's a male saying, I have delayed ejaculation or I have erectile dysfunction, we say as a rule out, not as a diagnosis, as a rule out, you need to ask them about their porn use. Mm-hmm. Is this true for women as well? What is your brain used to, first of all? And then secondly, what's your body used to? If someone's masturbating compulsively 3-5 hours a day, they're desensitized mentally, emotionally, and physically.
Mm-hmm. And I think real quick, it goes two ways here, which is if someone's seeing a client who presents for sex therapy, and when we do the intake, they haven't said anything about porn, and they discover, you know, the clinician discovers, whoa, they're watching 8 hours of porn, that's why you can't get an erection, or you have delayed ejaculation, you have intimacy issues.
Mm-hmm.
So we will often get that client who, that's again why it's important to ask the questions.
Sure.
Maybe not physiological.
Right, so to start with, are they watching, a lot of times people say, I've stopped watching pornography for 30, 60, 90 days, suddenly I don't have the problem anymore. If that's not the case, we have porn addicts taking Viagra and Cialis. They don't realize it's because their body, their brain is used to a chemical combination that when they get in bed with their partner, why am I not arousing? It's like a record scratch. Mm-hmm. I have clients who don't know that reference, by the way. Record scratch.
That is depressing.
I'm getting scared. I mean it. So it's a right. The brain says, what is this? I'm used to this. I'm used to safety, and I'm used to being isolated, and I'm used to dopamine blasts like this. And what is this that you're giving me here? Even if it's someone you're in love with and very attracted to. It can happen. Like I said, not all the time, but it happens a lot. Decreased libido for that same reason. Need to fantasize about porn or maintain an erection. I hear that so often. So John, would you be so kind as to turn the lights off again? I just want to quickly show, we don't have enough time to really process this, which I wish we did today to really talk about it. But about 3 years ago, I think, the New York Post had some men do a study, and they were allowed themselves to be photographed while they were masturbating. And these are men who said that they were had compulsive or addiction with pornography. They allowed themselves to be, these are real photographs of men as they were watching pornography. So we'll just be quiet, and there's 3 slides of different men. And just check in with yourself. What do you think? What do you feel? What do you notice on these guys' faces?
How about some just one word answers, popcorn style?
Trance.
Trance.
High.
Glazed over.
High, mm-hmm. glazed over.
Mm-hmm. Hungry.
Hungry, sure.
How about sad.
Sad. I remember once, you can go ahead and turn on, John. Thank you, Billy. What's that? Someone just said something.
It's a lack of joy.
So. Lack of joy, yeah. Right. Do they look like they're having fun?
No.
Serious.
Right, serious.
And again, that's the dissociated state.
Yeah.
I'm not here anymore.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, if these guys, by the way, were walking, let's say, down the street or in a club or a coffee shop, I even, in general, these are attractive men. Like, we would think, like, oh, that guy's a very attractive man. But they do certainly don't look that way in this light. What I mean to say is in their state of mind, their state of being. So Dan, you want to talk about the JAMA article? Oops, I went backwards.
It's so decided.
Let's not
watch.
Go backwards. Okay.
So there was recently, very recently, I guess in May, you know, I was talking about with research on gay men and pornography, we shouldn't feel too bad because there are really no studies on pornography and men in terms of neurobiology. So this study was posted, yeah, in the end of July. It was a very small sample. It was only 64 patients who, you know, described being porn watchers, healthy, quote unquote, and they were studied viewing porn and what happened in the brain. What happened in the brain is an issue. It really was brain and pornography. And what showed was a correlation, right, between pornography viewing and the gray matter volume. So the gray matter in the brain is basically what is, you know, it's sort of how we assess, how we process information, how rational thought, all of those parts of our brain that are thinking, some of them are thinking parts. So what it showed was there was a negative correlation between the hours of porn watching and brain activation during sex cues. And we're talking here about the right caudate of the brain. The right caudate is very much in the center of the brain. It's also responsible for understanding pleasure seeking, right? I'm gonna make sure I have my notes. Pleasure seeking, voluntary movement, learning, sleep, memory, and social behaviors. And what is a part of a porn addiction is the antithesis of social behavior. So it did show that there was a decrease in the white, the gray matter in the brain. The problem was, this was a chicken and egg sort of study. They don't know if people are born with less gray matter and thus are more, addiction is more, can be more prevalent, they're more likely to be addicted, or they become addicted to pornography and the matter in the brain sort of decreases. So it's a big could study. Right, but it shows again, we need to look at the neurobiology of addiction, porn addiction specifically, as you write your book, hopefully there'll be more studies to look at, or we're kind of shooting in the dark. Mm-hmm. We can treat it as an addiction, but what's really happening in the brain beyond the dopamine, norepinephrine, etc.
There was also another one I was just mentioning to Dan this morning about a study with 257 men, and this is all self-report. All of these are self-report. This one was taking three narcissism self-tests as well, and they found a high correlation between higher narcissistic traits and porn addiction, all by self-report. Again, chicken or egg. And these, even the people publishing the studies are saying, is this a causation or correlation? And there's more need. So what they said, in order to have a causation study, what they need is naive subjects. And what that means is people who haven't watched porn. We're still looking for that person. That's a huge problem. So will we ever have that study? My fingers are crossed. So assessment. As clinicians, how do we assess for it? One of the things I say that's really important is, with my clients, this is what I do every day. I love it. This is my passion. However, sometimes I forget that the person coming in on day one, it's not their passion. They've never talked about this stuff before. So I need to remind myself every time I'm addressing pornography or any sexual addiction issues with somebody, this is the first time they've talked about it. And it can be a really, really healing, shame-reducing experience to talk to somebody who is, pardon me for saying, loving, accepting, non-shaming to them. That experience alone has people walking out sometimes feeling like they've taken 1,000 pounds off their chest. So that's first and foremost, is to get to the place inside of ourselves where we realize this person's in pain. When asking these questions, how often, for how long, where do you watch it, what types, the answers to these questions help tell the story. It's very different someone saying, I binge watch pornography for 8 hours at a time and I have one orgasm and I do it between 8 p.m. and 4 a.m. in the morning and this and this, and I watch pornography with beating and this and that, than someone who watches it 2-3 times a week and they watch this kind and they do it in this, you know, at work, for example. Very different template. We just need to know this information so we can help tell the story. And to reflect what I just said to the client is really important. To say, like, I so appreciate the fact that we're talking about this. And I, you know, as a clinician, being able to say, thank you for having the courage to come talk to me about this. And I really hold it in very high regard. So thank you.
And I think it's important with most sex addiction behaviors, addiction in general, they're going to initially underreport.
Uh-huh.
So you're going to have to do that sort of investigation, you know, in terms of their comfort level with us. And I just want to say, you know, I have clients, I think we have clients, who can't say some of the words about things they look at.
Yeah.
So they speak sort of in metaphor, they speak in very general, because they have so much shame about it. And so the more you know about different kinds of porn, as a clinician, the better off you are. Because you want them to know that you're an expert, not in viewing pornography necessarily, but understanding these behaviors, and that you can normalize them for them.
Right, and that's a good point. If they say, I've had people say, it's kind of a common term, like, I just watch pretty much vanilla porn. Okay, and I know what that means. What does it mean to you, sir?
Yeah.
You, madam. What is vanilla porn? Oh, you people punching each other in the face.
Yeah.
Ah, now we're talking about something different. What is vanilla porn to you? Because it's different for me and that person. It's different for all of us in this room. Right. So don't shy away from specifics, you know. Hold in the acceptance, the unconditional positive regard Carl Rogers likes to talk about and I love in the room, is like, to hold them is like, I don't look at you shamefully in what you're telling me. Can we get to that place as we're talking about that? While we ask, as our comfort level can affect the client's comfort level with being honest with us. So do we need to process our countertransference? Yeah. Have I ever wanted to crawl out of my skin when people have told me what they've seen? Yes, absolutely. I hold in the moment, and then I go spill my guts to somebody who's not my client. Say, oh my gosh, I'm like traumatized by what I just heard. I haven't even seen it. Could we ever hear something from someone describing the kind of porn they watch that would turn us on? Yeah, I think so. Sure. Managing our countertransference like anything else, right? Just being able to talk about what comes up for us. We're all sexual creatures, thank God. So we don't hold ourselves to any higher standard than we hold our clients. I need help. After I talk to people, whether it's, it doesn't happen a lot that I'm aroused, but it's like, I'll hear something and think, oh, what? That's shocking to me. That's arousing to me. That's interesting to me. And I want to say this carefully, it's like, our clients will say something, oh, there's a website where you can go look at this and that. There's a website where there's not even porn, where I think, I'd like to look at that website. That'd be interesting. And some of those times, like, wait, I don't want to look at that website. I don't, not because I think it's wrong or bad, but it's just not part of what I want in my life. So, there are assessment tools. You go on our website and you have there on the PowerPoint the ISST, the Internet Sex Addiction Screen Test. It's private, it's self-report, it's yes or no questions. It tells them if you're in this range, or this range, this is what we see. So call us, don't call us, don't worry about it, or maybe, you know, it tells them how. Yeah. So if a 6 is a cutoff, let's say, and they score a 19, they know, you know, that they're way over the cutoff.
And I was just going to say, some people don't know they're porn addicts.
Right.
Right? Until they do that, and they come in and they're like, oh, I think I'm a porn addict.
Sure.
Right? Because there's a very, and we all have a narrow conception, most people, of what that means.
Right.
Right?
So that's it. So on our website, we have that. You can direct people there, and it's just a self-test, and they can bring you the copy. And then keep the sex addiction criteria in mind.
Yeah. So we're not going to read through all of them. There are a lot of them.
And you have them.
Yeah, the presence of 3 or more of these symptoms. This is for sex addiction, not just porn addiction, because you're going to have people who come in who are addicted to escorts, massage parlors, affairs all the time. What else?
Oh, exposition.
Right, exhibitionism, voyeurism, frauderism, other paraphilias. So you want to look at all of these to see what's going on with your client.
Yeah.
It's really important that you go through these in your mind and ask them the questions.
And I think this is one of the biggest ones to look out for. What's the difference between problematic and behaviors and addiction? Ongoing but unsuccessful efforts to stop or reduce or control the behavior. I can't stop. A lot of people in personally and professionally, do you think I'm a porn addict? I say, try to stop. Let's talk in a week.
Right.
What happened?
And number 6, that's addiction.
Yeah.
My life gets smaller, 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 smaller.
Mm-hmm. Right. And we already talked about tolerance. Tolerance and withdrawal are all part of sex and porn addiction. People will have emotional and even physiological responses to it. And tolerance, like I said, it's just variety. First they needed this, now they need something a little more visceral, a little more off the beaten path, and more and more and more. That's how the brain reacts. Just like an alcoholic. I used to drink a six pack, then it took 12, then it took 18, then it took hard whiskey. It's like our body and our brain react the same way. So, what do I do now? So I have a porn addict.
She's a porn addict.
So that's us, the clinician. What do we do now? The person comes in, we've talked to them about it. They've taken the assessment screening test. We look at it with them. Yes, you are addicted to porn. What do I do with that? Is a question that I would be asking right now. So first thing we got to do, tell them what to do. Give them things to go do. This is very cognitive behavioral in the beginning. Do. Go do these things. Come back. Tell me how they work. The best thing we can do, I'm happy that you all have this. It's like, this is just, go to this slide right here. Defining sexual sobriety, which means what do we got, 3 minutes?
Yes.
Okay. Kana says 3 minutes. What is sexual sobriety? For some, it's just porn. I'm addicted to porn. Anything else is open season and it's fine. Just, I'm going to abstain from porn. We work on an abstention of sobriety model here. We send them to 12-step groups. There are many. SAA is one, Sex Addicts Anonymous, Sexaholics Anonymous, Sex and Love Addicts Anonymous, Sexual Compulsives Anonymous. Big fellowships here in LA. Thank God, they're fabulous. Defining what it is, creating a circle plan, which Dan is going to talk about, getting them to 12-step meetings, give them reading. In your PowerPoint, there's resources to books. In the Shadows of the Net, The Porn Trap, Out of the Shadows, a lot of books that are on here on your list. Just have them go get one of those books, especially In the Shadows of the Net. It's a book about porn addicts and what to do. Sponsorship once they get involved in program, and then working the 12 steps. Teaching them healthy coping mechanisms, what to do, like we were talking about earlier, like John was saying, it's that what do I need to stop doing, and then what can I do to replace those behaviors? Addressing toxic shame, that comes a little later, because that's going to come up. It's like a champagne bottle. I've been corking down these feelings, distracting, numbing on purpose without realizing it. Now all that's coming up. It should. So we should let them know that and help them process what comes up. Affirmation of healthy sexual behavior, which some of them don't know what that is, and we can help them. And then easy does it. Take it easy with them. Let them go step by step. Let them know that they're an addict and they're recovering from that, not to expect that this should be easy, because it shouldn't.
And I will go very quickly with this, but one of the things that, as Greg pointed out, is that we have them create right away is a circle plan. And this is something that guides them in how they're going to work towards sobriety. Inner circle, these are the things I will not do. Watch pornography, masturbate, whatever else it is. Middle circle, these are the triggers. Whether it's turning on the computer, feeling lonely, seeing some sexual content on television. And then outer circle, what are the healthy behaviors? Going for a run, exercising, time with family, meetings, sponsorship. I think every addict should be creating a circle plan, whether you're a sex addict, an alcoholic, or a drug addict. Because mm-hmm. this is what it's about here. What Greg said real quickly is sexual sobriety is not, you know, eventually it's not going to be complete abstinence from any kind of sex. Whereas alcohol drug addictions, the 12-step model is you don't drink no matter what. And that's what makes this complicated to work with these clients. What is healthy sex versus what is my addictive behavior? Was that fast enough?
That was great. Okay. and we don't want them to be sexually anorexic. We don't want them to be asexual. We want them to have healthy sexuality. And this is step one in creating that. Not to kill their sex life, but to help them stop what they can't stop doing. Not what we think is bad for them, what we think is normal, but what they can't stop, and because it's having negative effects on their life. In your PowerPoint, we have some notes about teenagers and parents. Just look those over on your own time, about how to talk to parents, about blocking, about what to do with their kids and internet, how to talk to our teenage and younger clients who probably are at least watching porn, which could be perfectly fine. But the main thing that we really want to get across, and I think we've done it, Daniel, is to just put forth, we have to be assessing for this. We're trained. Suicidality, drugs and alcohol, danger to self, danger to others, like first session. Now, does porn need to be part of the first session? Maybe, maybe not. Not necessarily. It's not like they're going to, you know, they're going to die if they go home and watch porn. But it has to be part of the assessment process today in this world that we live in. When 7.5 seconds from now, we could have anything we want on our phones, here in my pocket, let alone on a computer in an isolated room, because it changes the brain. So as clinicians, can we be bold enough? Can we talk about our sexuality in our own therapy, with our own friends, in our consultation group, so that when we talk about it with our clients, it's something that we can't go any farther than we're willing to go ourselves, right? So can we look at our own behavior? Healthy, not healthy, it's fine. But then to be able to talk to our clients about it, we have to be assessing for it, because it's changing their lives for sure. So why don't we finish there, Daniel?
I think we're finished there.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Kate, are there cards? Are cards out there? Thank you all.